as we all know, he was just a puppet in his hand.
And he surrounded the court with the people that he trusted in order to consolidate power.
So you will see in the same family, in a way, the history repeating itself. Hello everyone and welcome to Tariq. And welcome to the special segment, Rubaru with the Rulers of Delhi. And the ruler for today is Muizuddin Kaikobad. From the last episode, we all know that Kaikobad sat on the throne. He was the grandson of the last Sultan Balban. And jo Kaikobad the, he was just 17 or 18 years of age when he sat on the throne in 1287 CE. When we talk about him, he had a very strict childhood. His tutors were very strict. He was not allowed to look at women. He was not allowed to taste wine. He had a very strict environment around him, and he was also well versed in calligraphy, in archery, in all sorts of things that a sultan should know or a prince should be learning. But jab wo takht par baithe, to he took a somersault and he gave himself to debauchery, to wine and venery. Jab Balban the, to the whole atmosphere of the court was very strict. Nobody was allowed to laugh, nobody was allowed to be, you know, happy, or everybody should be stern when they were in the court.
Because he himself was
like that. But then when Kaikobad sat on the throne, everything just turned, changed. And jab wo tha, the court was just, you know, had people who were just buffoons, pleasure seekers. And it totally became opposite of all that, you know, that stern atmosphere that was there during the Balban's period. It was just total chaos in a way.
It turned into a circus.
Circus. It was informal and it was something that a court should not have, was not supposed to be. Kaikobad, he had established his own city, his own palace called in Kailogiri or Kilokiri, which was also one of the cities that we don't know much about, on the banks of Yamuna. And he was, at that point of time, was siraf or siraf कोर्ट में रहते थे जहाँ पे डांसिंग गर्ल्स होती थी, म्यूजिशियंस होते थे, सिंगिंग गर्ल्स होते थे. एंड हिज इंस्टेड ऑफ मलिक्स और आमिर्स टू बी हिज कंपेनियंस, ही वाज ओनली सराउंडेड बाय वुमेन एट दैट पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम. ही ओनली इंडल्ज्ड इन वेनरी एंड ही ओनली इंडल्ज्ड इन प्लेजर सीकिंग एक्टिविटीज एट दैट पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम, विच ही शुड हैव रिस्ट्रेन्ड फॉर सम टाइम ऑब्वियसली बिकॉज ही जस्ट फ्रेशली सैट ऑन द थ्रोन. बर्नी कहते हैं कि He was so preoccupied with all this that this man just became over, because of the overindulgence when it comes to alcohol or the other pleasure seeking activities, that he just became pale and weak. Instead of, you know, going for a hunt, or instead of having a proper, you know, training, he just indulged himself in all that debauchery and all that venery. कि वो वीक पड़ गए, इतना वीक कि इवन व्हेन ही वुड राइडिंग अ हॉर्स, ही वुड नॉट राइड इट फास्ट बिकॉज ही वाज सो वीक. सो दैट वाज व्हाट काइकोबाद वाज, अ मैन ऑफ जस्ट 17 और 18 इयर्स ओल्ड, एंड हाउ हिज ग्रैंडफादर वाज, ही वाज टोटली ऑपोजिट.
जाहिर सी बात है, अगर काइकोबाद इज बिजी थ्रोइंग प्लेजर पार्टीज एंड नॉट रियली यू नो पेइंग अटेंशन टू द मैटर्स ऑफ द स्टेट, द एम्पायर कुड नॉट हैव लास्टेड इवन फॉर अ वीक. Barney writes that there were two pillars of the court who looked after the state affairs. One was Malik Qawamuddin Alaka Dabir and the other was Malik Nizamuddin. Both of these Maliks, they were the remnants of the Shamsi and the Balbani Turks, and they were also well versed in state affairs. They had a proper idea of how the state should function, the administration and all of that, and they you know, looked after the empire when Kaikobad could not. Now, Malik Qawamuddin did not have any political aspirations. He only wanted to do his job and not be bothered by the politics of you know, the state. But Malik Nizamuddin was very interested in what was happening around him. Now, agar hum yaad karenge Balban ke time pe jo Delhi ke kotpal the, Malik Nizamuddin unke nephew and son-in-law the, and because Malik the kotpal of Delhi had given his backing for Kaikobad, this Malik Nizamuddin used that to consolidate his own position, and he rose to the post of Naib Mamlakat, which is a very high rank in the Sultanate court. Jab Malik Nizamuddin, when he became the Naib Mamlakat, he chose his supporters for important roles like the Naib Wakildar, the Amir Hajib, and the Sarjandar, and he surrounded the court with the people that he trusted in order to consolidate power. And jaise jaise jo kaikobad hai, the more he was indulging himself and, you know, loosening his grip on the state, that is when Malik Nizamuddin sort of consolidated all of that, and he started aspiring to maybe overthrow kaikobad and take his position. Itna ho gaya tha that while Nizamuddin was looking after the administration, his wife was looking after the palace, and she was even called the mother of Kaikobad.
Here you would also see history repeating itself. Jab Nasiruddin Mahmud jo the, he was the sultan, and Balban was his Naib-e-Mamlakat. He was exercising all his powers. And almost, and you, as we all know, he was just a puppet in his hand. जब आप इनको देखते हैं तो कायकोबाद भी पपेट हैं और मलिक निजामुद्दीन जो है, he is exercising all the powers and he wanted to get the throne. Yeah. He wanted to just dispose the sultan as well. So you will see in the same family, in a way, the history repeating itself. Because Nizamuddin जो थे, मलिक निजामुद्दीन, he was gaining a lot of prominence in the court. So there are a lot of things that, you know, allegations against him. Jo Kai Khusrut hai, he was the son of Balban's favorite child, as we all know. And Balban wanted him to sit on the throne, Kai Khusrut. But whatever the fate decided, ki Kaikobad would sit on the throne. But ab kya hua ki now Nizamuddin started playing a lot of games. Barni kehte hain ki when Kaikobad was drunk, he killed Kai Khusro in Rota. He got him killed. But alag jo aur bhi alag jaise sources hain, wo ye batati hain ki Nizamuddin, what Malik Nizamuddin did was, the Amirs and the Maliks that supported Kai Khusro, he got them all killed or sent them on exile. And the Kotwal, jo Malik Nizamuddin the, us Kotwal ke jo nephew the or son-in-law bhi the, jo Kotwal the, he forged documents by saying that now Kaikobad is on the throne, it's better that you leave the city. You leave the city and you go somewhere else. So the Kaikhusro, he went to Multan, stayed there at some time. He used to feel very bad for himself at that point of time. And tehlte-tehlte wo Ghazni pe chale gaye, and then finally to the Mongol city that was there. Kuch kehte hain ki because he spent all his money, Kai Khusro returned to Delhi, to Mandoli, which is in Hindustan, which was a part of India. So jab wo wahan aaye wapas, to Nizamuddin, he just got berserk and he asked Kaikobad, you see, your cousin Kai Khusro, he had submitted himself to the Mongols so that he can get the throne. So this is also one of the reasons that Kaikobad got Kai Khusro killed, and Kai Khusro was beheaded in Mandoli. Aur sirf yahi nahi, even the wazir of the empire, who was Khwaja Khatir, he was made to sit on a donkey, and he was paraded all around. And this was, you know, the other Amirs and the Malik, they were disgusted by the sight. And but they could not say a word to him because they all were scared of him. And us time par jo ye Malik Nizamuddin the, he didn't want any sort of opposition. So the first plan he chalked down was how to get rid of the opposition that could, you know, affect him in a way, that could affect his power and his authority.
You know, we can see that Balban also did something similar, but he was more tactful and graceful in how he executed his plans, as opposed to Nizamuddin, yeah, who was very brash and, you know, he was very hasty, I think, in his attempt.
And Balban had that sophistication in him, yeah, whenever he would execute his plans. But this guy, I think too much greed hit his head, and he wanted the power as soon as possible, the way he wanted, without thinking, yeah, of a plan.
Like Balban got rid of the Chehelghani Turks, we can see that Malik Nizamuddin was also following a similar principle, where he wanted to just get rid of all the Turkish officers in the court, anybody who could be an opposition to him, he was trying to get rid of them. So he deceitfully, what he did, he forged papers from the governor of Multan stating that, you know, Multan was able to, you know, withstand a Mongol attempt, like the imperial forces were able to defeat a Mongol army. And on that pretext, he called all the officers to the court to, you know, sort of pay their regards to the emperor, ki dekho itna bada cheez ho gaya hai, aake, you know, you should greet the emperor on this victory. And when the officers came, he either got them imprisoned or he killed them. A lot of posts were also reshuffled and he only gave them to the people who were supporting him or, you know, who enjoyed his confidence. Now, while this chaos was happening in the center, Tamar Khan actually invaded. So there actually was a Mongol invasion that happened during this time. And they ravaged the country from Lahore to Multan at that time. And imperial forces were then sent to deal with the threat, and then the Mongols also receded. Now, before this invasion also, there were a few, you know, Mongols who had converted to Islam and they were settling, and they had settled down in the Sultanate Empire. And Malik Nizamuddin forged again the Sultan's orders, and he also got them executed. So he was executing officers left, right and center. He even executed the governor of Multan and even the governor of Baran, who were very important officers under Balban. Now you can say that the power, you know, sort of went to his head very fast, and it was coming to a point where his father-in-law and uncle, Malik Fakhruddin, who was the Gopal of Delhi, he also got worried. And Barney has a tendency of theatricizing his account, and he gives a very, you know, poignant recitation between the two of them, where the Kotwal of Delhi is, you know, telling him, you know, this is not our position, yeah. You know, watch where you are, this is the maximum to which we can rise.
You're exceeding
and
a line.
Yeah, you're crossing a line now. And then, you know, Malik Nizamuddin says that I have shed too much blood, like I'm too far in this game to, you know, now back out.
Yeah.
And so, you know, very dramatically, the Kotwal of Delhi says, well, then you have condemned all of us to die.
Yeah.
And but regardless, Malik Nizamuddin continues with his ways, and with his, because the power had really gone to his head. And I think the way it was with Balban as well, although Balban was more tactful and Nizamuddin was not.
When Kaikobad sat on the throne, at that time, when his father was Kaikobad ki Burga Khan, he made himself the king of Lakhnauti under the title of Sultan Nasiruddin, and khutba bhi padha gaya unke naam ke under, and he started also getting coins minted under his name. Burga Khan jante the ki jo unke bete hain Kaikobad, he was living a very dissipated life. Overindulgence was there, and he knew that Malik Nizamuddin was responsible for all this. He knew that Malik Nizamuddin was trying to dispose all the Maliks and Amirs from the court, also also trying to make his son the puppet, and soon he will also get rid of the Sultan. So, after जब कायकोबाद के दो साल गुजर गए थे आज सुल्तान, तो बुगरा खान ने एक लेटर भेजा एक मैसेंजर के थ्रू कि he wanted to meet his own son. इस पर्टिकुलर अकाउंट के दो वर्जन हैं, एक अमीर खुसरो जी कहते हैं और दूसरा बर्नी. अमीर खुसरो बोलते हैं कि बुगरा खान केम started he set out on a journey towards Delhi. He marched out of Lakhnauti with his army, and as soon as he reached Bihar, Kaikobad also left Delhi with his army to challenge his father. Barney कहते हैं कि Kaikobad was the one who set on his journey with his large army to challenge his father or to meet his father. तो जब वो almost थोड़े करीब आ गए थे एक दूसरे के location wise, तो Bughra Khan had sent his correspondence, his messenger to summon his son to meet him, but he refused. And then he sent another message while saying, you know, this was I'm supposed to sit on the throne, I'm the son of Balban, and you know, it is my prerogative to sit on the throne, but it can go to you after me, after I die. So Kaikobad was like, no, it's not like that. You have to fight for it, like how Iltutmish fought for it, how Balban fought for it. You have to fight for it, then only you'll get the throne. in this whole course of conversation between father and son, by you know, sending messengers, you would only say that Kaikobad was insulting his father repeatedly. But Bughra Khan did not say a word. Unhone sab saha, and he understood why Kaikobad was, you know, behaving in such a way. He felt sorry for his son because he knew that it was Nizam Malik Nizamuddin, you know, who had created, who had made Kaikobad like that, who was filling his ears against everybody, and he knew that. And Malik Nizamuddin also did not want that both of them should have a very cordial relationship. He purposely, when you know, purposely created chaos. So ultimately, you know, Bughra Khan sent another message that to have an interview with him, with his own son, like how a father and son should meet. And finally that happened. But Malik Nizamuddin made it sure that, you know, he had kept such court ceremonies, such court etiquettes that were pretty humiliating for Bughra Khan to accept. But Bughra Khan, being very calm and composed at that point of time, he accepted all those court etiquettes. And when he reached the court of Kilugadi, and he bowed down in front of the Sultan, he prostrated, kissed the ground, he kissed his feet. And though at that point of time Kaikobad was very stern in his outlook, he also melted and he, you know, hugged his father lovingly and dearly. Started weeping. जब ये सारी ceremonies खत्म हो गई, you know, उसके बाद Bughra Khan hugged his son Kaikobad and he requested him in front of all the Maliks that you should not indulge yourself in all these pleasure-seeking activities and not give yourself to debauchery or wine or venery. You should be acting like a sultan. You should be behaving like one sultan and you should be very concerned about the administration. And while saying a goodbye, he spoke in his ear that you have to get rid of Malik Nizamuddin.
Now, although Kaikobad promised his father that he would stay away from pleasure-seeking activities, that promise only lasted a week. And soon, because of his excessive drinking, he fell ill. Now, Kaikobad had asked Malik Nizamuddin to go to Multan, and Nizamuddin kept delaying it on various pretexts. The Turkish officers found this a very opportune moment and they poisoned him. Now, Barney, although was very critical of Nizamuddin and his ambitious ways, he did state that he was a very able administrator, and when he died, and because of the state of Kaikobad himself, the administration fell to ruins. Although there were older officers from the time of Balban who came to help with the administration, but it was not like it could not beat the effect of as it was under Nizamuddin. Now, since Malik Nizamuddin was no longer on the scene, Kaikobad summoned Malik Firoz Khalji from Samana, and he gave him the post of Ariz-e-Mamlik, and he also made him the governor of Baran and gave him the title of Shaista Khan. Now, Malik Firoz Khalji and his brother Shihabuddin had served under Balban and had gained quite a reputation as able military officers and commanders, and had fought off the Mongols quite well. Now, by this time, the court also saw a division of the nobles into two factions. One, jinka face the Malik Khalji, they stood for just bringing in new elements in the court, and they wanted new officers and maybe even a new ruling family. And the other faction, which was backed by Malik Aitmar Sirka, they wanted the continuation in how the Sultanate was functioning with the same Turkish nobles and the line of Balban, because the Turkish officers held quite a powerful position in the Sultanate and they just wanted to see that continue. And so for that, because Kaikobad had become paralyzed, he could not move his body and even his mind was not that great. So they raised his son Kaimurz to the throne with the title of Shamsuddin II. Now, once Kaimurz was raised to the throne, the aim of the Turkish nobility was to continue their power and to maintain the line of Balban. And the next mode of action was now to get rid of the other factions. So including Malik Khalji and any officer who was not of Turkish origin, they wanted to get rid of them. Now Malik Khalji, who was inspecting the royal forces at Bhagal Pahari, gets to know of this from the Naibe Amir Hajib, and he instantly moves to Khiaspur, where his quarters are. And he starts calling his family members from Baran on the pretext of preparing for an oncoming Mongol invasion. Many non-Turkish officers also then sided with Malik Khalji and gave him their support. Now the Turkish officers were also getting impatient, so they sent another messenger to Malik Khalji and they asked him to present himself in the court before Kaimuz. But at that time, Malik Khalji was reviewing the Kannauj forces, and so he told the messenger, you know, why don't you please wait while, you know, I'm taking care of this assignment, and as soon as I'm finished, we will go. And so the messenger, Kachin, he goes and he is waiting, you know, beside, under a tree, and when he's waiting there, they go and they decapitate him and they throw his body in the river Yamuna. Now after the beheading of Kachin, the conflict between the two groups becomes an open conflict, and the sons of Firoz Khalji, they rush into the palace and they capture Kaimuz and they bring him with him, and many of the Turkish officers also chase after them to get a hold of the boy king back, but they are killed. And even the sons of the Kotwal of Delhi, Malik Fakhruddin, are captured, and because he's so scared for his own sons, he dissuades the people of Delhi from following Kaimuz, and he just lets Khalji do what he wants to do.
Khaljis at that time were not so ready to take the power in their hands. The main mudda unka ye tha ki to act in the defense. So, but Kaimuz were then again was made to sit on the throne. He was back on his throne. He was sent to his palace in Kilogiri. And jo Malik Firoz Khalji the, he had asked, he gave the regency of the young prince to Malik Chajju. And khud unhone kaha ki he'll take the responsibility of the marches and the Multan marches that came under Multan, Dipalpur, then Bhatinda. But us time pe jo ye Malik Chajju the, he refused regency and he wanted Manikpur and Kara, the governorship of Manikpur and Kara. Even the old Kotwal, who was Malik Fakhruddin, he too rejected the regency. So ultimately the regency came in the hands of Malik Firoz Khalji. Firoz Khalji ko laga ki It would be a stupid thing to, you know, make Kaimuz the keep him on the throne. It will, in fact, in the future, it will create more chaos. So within 3 months, he has to think about a solution. Us time pe kehte Kaimuz ke naam ke sikke bhi jari kiye gaye the. Lot of people have discovered that. And uske baad kya hua? Jo Kaikobad the, jo Kaimuz ke hi father the, jinke baare mein abhi humne aapko bataya tha pehle. He was just living a very sad, melancholic life in his palace of Kilogiri, and there was this Malik whose father was killed by Kaikobad. He entered the palace and he wrapped Kaikobad's paralytic body in a bedsheet and threw him in the Yamuna, because obviously he could not, fight for him, as because he was paralyzed by then. And by throwing him, this ended the Turkish aristocracy, the Turkish slave nobility that was there, the whole Turkish empire, the Ilbari Turks, the whole phase of Turkish nobility and the Turkish rulers, it got ended here. And the Malik Firoz that we are, Khalji that we are talking about, is none other than Sultan Jalaluddin Khalji, who was the chacha or the uncle of Alauddin Khilji, who was again one of the well-known sultans of Delhi Sultanate. And with this end of the Turkish nobility and the Turkish rule starts a new era, a new dynasty of Khalji dynasty. I hope that you've liked today's episode. Please like, share and subscribe, and keep watching Tariq.